I was born in Nigeria. And I came to this country in 1985, April the 23rd, to study fashion design. I remember when I came, it was nice. I was 15. I was seeing white people. I was living in Toysil. After that, I went and lived in Camberwell with some of my friends. So later on, I met Agassi's dad, and he's from Cameroon, half Nigeria. We started living in New Park Road, and that's when I had Agassi.
My name is Sneakbo. My real name is Agassi Odeshino. Come from Brixton, South London. Brixton at that time, bro, the poverty was real. There was riots going on. It was different. It was madder than it is now, innit? My mum's a hard worker. When I was growing up, I always remember her having two jobs. She raised me and my two sisters. I didn't grow up with my dad, so yeah, I don't really have much to say about him. But there's a tennis player called Andre Agassi. The year I was born, that's when he won the championship. And my dad just named me after him. I feel like Agassi is the right way where the tennis player pronounces it. But my mom, because she's African, she says Agassi. Like, yeah. My dad should have gave me the first name, but he gave me his surname, Kiskoko.
Like, it wasn't a backy when he was in primary. But when he reached to secondary, he was having fights.
When I started year 7, my mom sent me to school in some uncle's shoes. This is before I knew about kickers and all that stuff. Someone used to always chat shit, and then we just had a little fight. But you know how school goes when you're a teenager. So yeah, I was with the main lads, and then that's when it was I'm going down another path. from that day, I knew. At first, my mom didn't even believe the teacher. She used to tell them, he's not like this at home. How can he? He just kept repeating. And on the last day, it was a fight that got me permanently excluded.
It was like having a bad friend. He doesn't listen to me anything, even angry with my brother, because my brother was telling him, don't do this, don't do that. I do all my best to make sure that he behaved himself in school, but it wasn't easy. And I was trying on my best to get him back in school.
I was out of school for a couple of weeks, and then they put me in a PRU. PRU is just for the bad kids. It's just the teachers ain't really onto you. You don't get in trouble. You don't do homework. You're just there. At that time, DVD days, I used to watch Sticky Business. And that's how I was aware of PDC, Roadside, all the rappers and the hood people. From South London was on that DVD.
I think time is money. I figure I come now. That is nothing.
The chains, the era hats, the black shades. At that time, that's what we want to be.
What you know about being in jail for New Year's Eve, where there's fights everywhere, screws run through and they're writing gear. Never got put on a diet in there. I told the servy boy to fill up my tray for a flight and cause a riot in there.
I was in the PRU for a couple months. I didn't get kicked out of there, but I stopped going there. Now I'm on the roads with my friends, we're doing whatever. But something's happened in the area, and it's people are mentioning my name or they think I'm involved. And yeah, it was just getting too much. And at that point, my mum was already onto me about going to Nigeria. So when it was kind of getting hectic for me as well, I just thought, yeah, this is the best time. Go Nigeria, chill off. And yeah, that's how I ended up in Nigeria. In Nigeria, yeah, no badness. The only badness I had was fights. When you're getting punished, it's sometimes they deal with you on the spot. Sometimes they will wait till the next day, when it's assembly and the whole school's outside. Everyone who got in trouble yesterday has to come to the front. And you all get beats one by one, depending on what teacher it is. Some use the belt, some use a branch, some use a ruler. If I was in England, I would have fought my teacher back. But when I know in Africa, if I slap this teacher, the whole school and the students are gonna deal with me. So yeah, I definitely cried in Nigeria one of them nights. Yeah, I was stressed out. In the boarding school now, some of them was singing African songs, church songs. And then they're drumming as well, with their hands on the table. One day I've just thought, I'm going to spit Giggs's bars. I'm sure it was talking the hardest, you know. Boom, I've done Giggs's bars now. they're gassed, they're loving it. The next day they told me, yo, do that one again. Or they're calling the older people in the year above us, like, look, listen to him, listen to him. I'm like, no, no, no. I need to write my own bars. From there, yeah.
It was staying with my mom. So we always fooled him. Are you okay? He would say, oh, me, I'm fine, but I need to come back to London. I miss London. I want to come back. I would say, no, you can't come back. The next minute, we just find out that he came back on his own.
I didn't know where my passport was for long. One day I found it, but I needed money. And then that's when I've hit up Judge of Souls and I asked him, can you do me a favor? But yeah, big up Judge of Souls. Get me, he's the reason I got back early. So after I got back from Nigeria, the next school I went to was Lily and Bailey's.
Agassi, Babatunde, Odusina, that banging school.
You know what it is, yeah? No one used to call me Babatunde till like secondary school. I remember being in the classroom and the teacher is doing the register. And I just knew, once she says my name, something's gonna happen anyway. I just knew. The teacher was reading out the register and then, yeah, she said my name. Someone said, huh? There was a reaction like that that happened and the whole class started laughing. That day I had to flip it on one of the students in the class, but that school was hood, man. Like, I met all my hood friends from there, all my hood girlfriends from there. Like, the roads was more my focus than studying.
It's the Russ Clark, Brixton president, yeah? Sneakbo, are you stupid? Bear man chatting shit, talking about getting man's guap up. Everybody, you man are broke, yeah? Nowhere near my level, you feel me? You man still get duty solicitors, blood. And like me, Russ Clark, pay my lawyer. I'm man busting these cases, when man spleeze your Russ Clark, but you stupid. Real Brixton riders, done not. I'll take them. Oh my Ross Clark, geez, gas gang, gang.
Gas gang. It's a group of us from Brixton, Angel Town, Mansfield, Loughborough area. Some do music, some do what they do, and yeah, we're just all brothers. There was a group called PDC Brats, and there's a group called Tiny OC. We're all brethrens, we all rep them two things. One day, some guy that I've grew up with, he was just getting bullied and like, I just felt like certain people that are not on nothing are just talking shit to him because they think he's a victim. So I didn't like it. And then when they said he's not a part of the PDC OC no more, that night when I went home, for some reason, I don't know why I was chilling and I just thought, let me make my thing or let me make our thing. Cool. From my name, I just took different things that can go with grass. So like grinding, stack, gripping, and yeah, that's where it came from.
Cool, so you got your gang now. Like, did Judge Souls give you any tips on
how to start? No. Judge didn't give me no tips. It's not even like I was starting a gang. It was just naturally happening. I didn't think today, yo, I'm starting a gang, next week we're gonna be big. No, it's just life. It was just life. This is what man's repping, this is what man is. And at that time, it's like, everyone's on what I'm on. This is even before I'm rapping, they're on what I'm on. So slowly, the main ones just started coming. And then from there, the whole neighborhood was gas gang. I didn't have no plan. I just thought, it's gang shit. I'm gonna die or get 30 years soon. This is what it is. This is life, like literally.
And as the founder, obviously, you have to be the most active.
Fucking, no. This is what I'm saying. It weren't like, how can I put it, man? Even when I made it, I'm not trying to be no founder or I have to do this or I have to get all the grub for everyone. And no, it weren't like that. I just named this thing this. And this is what we're on. And that's what, certain men are more active than me, but they're just, I was just that guy. No matter what, you could be, you have more money, you could be banging out more. It's just, Bo's that guy. That's all it was.
And then how did you market the gun though? The market was down, effectively, because I had about it in Northwest.
Brother, these questions are mad. But anyway, cool. Yeah, I didn't market no gang. How can I put it? There's no tactic. It's just literally them days, we were just beefing the pagans, the Peckham Utes. When I'm even making music or my friends are making music, this is not for no one in North, West, East. This is literally them to understand. On Saturday or whenever something happened, we're onto you lot and they're onto us, and that's literally all it is.
Bullet! Rookie man, let the bullet off. Push the clip in, aim up, then pull it off. Your hot head, I'ma pull it off the.
Pecky man, give gunshot. Gunshot, one shot, shot. Bust up till the gun stop, stop. And my squad stack guns like a gunshot. Shot on the yellow block, posing with my gun cock.
The beef with Brixton and Peckham, till this day, I don't even know the incident that started it. This beef's been happening before us, but with my generation now, I know it started from a school called Micah Ramsey near Campbell and Mitesfield. Some of the Peckham boys go there and some of the Brixton boys go there. And like, in school they'll have problems, after school they'll have problems, and that's between them. But then it got to a point where now, us lot that don't even go to the school will come and help our friends that actually go to the school. And then, yeah, Peckham boys that don't go to that school as well, they'll come. Certain people get caught in the morning. If you get caught in the morning, you phoned all your friends and they're coming after school now to catch someone. And it was literally just school until someone actually got caught and maybe stabbed or bust their head or something. That's when it became, forget that, it's Friday, Saturday, Sunday, like, yeah, it's happening everywhere and anywhere now with the Peckham London.
I popped up in 03, now Sneakbo rolling with some OGs. Heard a couple pussy hoes are looking for me, but you could catch Sneakbo on the back streets.
Back roads.
And you'll be pissed when I'm at these. I fire shots and you'll be pissed when my slugs eat. I don't really give a fuck about your dumb team. Won't ride one straight to the police. Niggas shook when they hear about GG. Sneaks, coops, art as a BE. Even got a couple killers in my YG. Skills, clicks, H-Man's a young sneak.
Gas gang.
I'm gonna ride on your dumb team. From the youngest to the chicks and the OGs. Niggas know I don't chat when I mean beef. Cause we got a couple sticks and a bag of tea.
Listen, shower. Listen. I can show you how to make money. Listen,
homes. Yeah, cool. Let me explain that video as well. Basically, we're just going for a ride through Canberra. On the way to Peckham, someone saw two bikes outside the shop. They jumped off. They've took them bikes. As that's happening, there's like four TSG vans driving towards us. On the camera, I can see what's happening now. It's like the Peckham boys came out somewhere. I don't know where they came from, but because I was there, I could vouch for all them Brixton boys that, yo, the TSG was coming towards them, and that's why everyone done a U-turn and started ducking off. When I diverted to my own way, I did get chased by feds. When I was there now and I got stopped, I've seen boys coming around the corner. I know they're waiting for me. Cool. I know I'm not gonna get nicked. So now I have a choice to let the feds go and these boys are definitely gonna follow me after, or I can act up. So cool. I started breathing heavy, like yo, I can't breathe. I had to sit down, lay down. The feds got the ambulance to come around. The ambulance came. I told them, don't worry about my bike. I don't even want it. Cool. It was a good bike as well, you know, but anyway, cool. They put me in the ambulance, took me to King's College. As soon as I got to King's College, I jumped out of the thing and I just cut back to the ends to Brixton, yeah.
It's no bobo, fam, I'm made for it. GAS, my gang, don't play with it. 4-5 salmon brats, do stay with it. If you're a known pagan, get blazed.
The first incident happened when I got stabbed was because me and my friend, we used to sell weed in Brixton. And then anyone who sells weed, we just used to take their weed and whatever cash they have on them. But then there was this guy that it's happened to him before. Yeah, I've seen him again selling weed, gone up to him, took the weed, punched him in the face, kept punching him. But I've heard pop. I didn't pay attention to the first pop, but then I heard it again. And then I've looked down and I've seen like feathers coming out of my jacket. As I've pushed him, I've dropped and I'm zipping down my jacket and then I've seen blood. And yeah, that's the first time I realized I got stabbed. I ran out the park, running down the road. I've seen someone else that shot weed, but I'm not even onto him for shotting or nothing. I'm onto him for his bike now. I'm telling him, yo, let me use your bike. He said, no. I told him I got stabbed. He didn't let me use the bike because he thought I'm not going to give it back to him. So I had to punch him again. Sorry, I'm not a violent person, but anyway, I had to punch him. Right, took the bike, rid to the hospital. And then when I got to the hospital now, I started feeling dizzy. Because it was like, I didn't get caught slipping and it was me looking for the trouble. It just made me know that I could get stabbed now. Like someone who I think is a neek can literally stab me. Before that, I just thought, yeah, just, who round here can touch me or talk to me? He answered it.
The window will be flying. I got the brown girls on my back. I had a white yak called Sash. Sex freak fam, I wanna give it to the batch. Whichever one's hot, I'ma take it to the max. And they all wanna know about gas. Gucci fam, I wave like that. My fresh haircut and my shades stay black. And I'm still from the hood, so it's still Air Max. Walk on my streets, Roger, better look back. A bricky young G's might start an attack. The Peckham ones go rat-a-tat-tat. But our big things go black-a-black.
So after I first got stabbed, now I'm just like with the man them, we're doing our thing. I can't remember how the year's going, but I was going to studio a lot with them.
I mean, with Gas Gang, when I was in school, going into college, the waves that they were making over in Brixton was ridiculous. Like, I'm a Lewisham boy personally, but even guys from our area were playing OC, we're playing Gas Gang because it was so influential.
At that time, the people that were Gas Gang, that rap, Odd Ads, Show Shallow, Coops, Political, Johnny Guns screamed it at one point. No, he weren't in it. He's in every gang. He weren't in my Gas Gang. But what was I gonna say? So the second time I got stabbed, I was driving in Tulsa. And I was with one of my youngies and he got problems with someone around there. But there's the Tulsa orders. Some of them went Lily and Bailey's. So yeah, I'm cool with them. I sell weed to them sometimes. But things have been going on with my youngers and their youngers. But anyway, cool. I've seen all of them. Like there's at least, it's summertime, there's at least 30, 40 of them on the main road. But it's not, you can't get to them unless you drive in the estate. So I've just thought to myself, let's go in the estate. But the car I'm driving is someone else's car. So cool. The other person's in the passenger seat. So I'm like, let's go in the estate. We've gone in the estate now. But they've already seen us go past on the main road. So they know we're coming. They know what car we're in. Cool. My plan was never to go there and even cause trouble. It was just to drive past, make them see we're about. One of them just ran in the road like it, like this. So I pressed the gas now, like I'm about to crash into him. It went straight into the wall. Now there's, I was just about to run someone over. And then there's 30 guys angry. And like the car was a Corsa, I remember clearly. I've turned the ignition. It's stalled anyway. I turned it on. It's stalled again because I'm panicking. As soon as it stalled that second time, I've just heard psh, 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 like all the windows smashing. And yeah, I seen a long Rambo. Someone from my school, this is someone from Lillian Bailey's, has got the Rambo. And then he's like, "Raw," he's like, "take off your chain." Took off my chain, poked me in my leg. Take off the ring, took off the ring, poked me, just kept poking me. But not all of the cuts were deep. But anyway, he poked me like 14 times. And then there's a little boy there. After everyone's ran off now, he's come back to the car and spat on me. I don't know why I remembered that, but anyway, cool, I remembered he spat on me. one of the older guys have said, you lot stop, take them hospital to the guy that owns the car.
When he was stabbed, they didn't tell me. He told anybody not to tell me, but my daughter told me later. So when my daughter told me, it wasn't easy, but we just went and see him and be praying. Up to today, I'm still praying for him.
After the second stabbing, I already recorded the song Hold You, and because I had that there, I just thought, yeah, let me shoot that video. And when I was doing all the dancing and stuff, that was literally to show the people that stabbed me a couple of weeks ago that, yo, I'm good. Everyone's been chatting shit about I'm crippled and I can't walk properly or whatever. So yeah, that's just where that energy came from in that video. I've never moved wavy. I've never danced so much. I've never moved my legs about. Now Russ and all these artists dancing their videos and whatnot. But you see then, no one was dancing. Everyone thought they're stiff and gangsters.
Yo, sexy, sexy, I'm a sex freak, sex. You wanna take it to the max like Pepsi. She wanna ride on my wave like Jetski. I need a hot little girl, no Jersey. Where's Oshin? Where's Lexi? Rihanna late night chat, wanna text me. Chrissy Minaj, my babe, yeah, you get me. Chris Tracebo, Mad Mons, Mama Becky.
When I dropped it, everyone in the area loved it. Everyone was playing it, and after that is when I felt famous.
Listen, listen. Look, listen, look, I've got him watching me now, like I've got a watch on me now. I'm popping the cow, strip locking it down. I catch a king, I'm popping his crown. You're the softest around, I'm the hottest around.
Around them times, I used to film music videos and hood freestyles. There was a friend of a friend that told me, oh yeah, like, Bo's on, you filming him on the estate. So then obviously, young kid like me, got my backpack on, hopped on a bus to Brixton, Angel Town, and I met up with Bo and he was on the block.
Sneaks on my boss, girls on my dick, they be beating the cock. Cats on my line, they be theming the rock. Bob be my name in the old slot. Sneaks, I'm a gem. Cruddy like me, no way, you're a gem. What? I put the beef on with the 4 or the 10. Ask little Mike, KJ was rolling again. Sneakbo known in the hood as a dun. Gunshots, everybody knows who I bun. I should have bun Teb with the 4-4 long. But after the rave, that Donny was gone.
Yeah, so the first time I went jail, it was for something petty. I can't even remember. It might have been breaching yacht or just something stupid. So yeah, the second time I went jail was for murder. And that was when Lil Zach got killed.
Police outside a specialist school in South London, where a teenage boy was stabbed to death in a fight. A 15-year-old boy suffered multiple injuries. He later died. A second boy's in hospital after being stabbed in the arm.
I was meant to do a video shoot that day, so yeah, I was up from early. Before I even came outside my house, different girls are phoning me from different schools. One's telling me, how can I do that? I'm thinking, what's she talking about? The next one's crying. Cool. Anyway, I'm walking out of my house. I've seen two guys. I didn't think nothing of it. They're right outside my house. Two guys sitting in the car. So as I'm walking up the road, two guys there, walked a bit further, another two guys, walked a bit further, another two guys. I got to the next car and I've seen my picture on one of their laps. When I've clocked this, my picture, I've like walked back and that's when all the doors open. They're running up to me, but they're moving aggressive. And instead of me to just think this is police, whatever, I'm like, what are you arresting me for? Murder. And they're like, yep, it's defo him. He defo, but I was nothing to do with it. It's just because of the phone calls of the girls like phoning me in the morning, someone died, someone got killed, made me even say, are you arresting me for murder? But cool, the police were so convinced that I done it because of that.
When I get to the shop, somebody phoned me that the police is in my house. They break the door, everything. So I said, what happened? They say my son killed Zach.
I knew quite early on from the police that the perpetrators of this crime were from the gas.
I'm in jail now and I've literally seen Ari. He's like the main guy in Roseside, in his section. He has got wrongfully arrested as well for a shooting and he had to do 10 years. So that was a year he got sentenced. So it's like, in my head, I know I'm coming home. because I haven't done nothing. But at the same time, I'm thinking, raw, like, I might get done dirty, like my man. I might literally never come home. The girls are pointing me out at ID parades. One girl said she saw me driving. The next girl said she saw me running with a knife. And it's Sneakbo gas gang. It's just too much.
Fam, you really brave. Do you really want two from the 3A? I've got a 3A, Sneak, you got a big pump. My gas niggas bus straps coming straight cut.
Now that I'm even here today, my friend that is in jail doing 18 years, a lot of people are not our friends no more. My life has changed since then. I'm a new person. I've done different things. I've gone to different countries. I've had a child, and that's just the life we were living.
Free gums.
My brother gums.
It's peak, man, losing better young cheese. Tiny troops and that. Don't watch now, my brother. Peak.
Don't know what it is. Back on our ass, man. Bullshit, yeah. Gas gun. Yeah.
It was very upsetting. Zach is like a family to me because I know his dad. So from there, everything was upside down.
My mom just has been a single mom, just suffering, raising me and Rod. Like, every time I get nicked for driving, for whatever dumb, silly stuff, she hates it. And I feel like I let her down then. So now that I've got nicked for this, the most serious crime, yeah, I felt so bad and I just, because I know I'm innocent, I knew when I come home, I'm going to show her, Mom, I was innocent. When I came home, that's exactly what I did. So I stopped shooting. I didn't want to go back to jail. I was just saying, yeah, I'm fully on music. So I met Shamar and he just wanted to help me.
First time I think I saw Sneakbo, I saw his video on Spear TV. It was a video when he was rapping on a Tupac beat.
You don't really want to see my dark side. I'm only 17 and I had a hard life. Growing up, saw a couple friends go by. So I'm still raw, well, I guess it's all life.
I remember asking my brother, who's that boy? Because he had like a flow. And my little brother at the time was like, yeah, that he turned into a cat or something. He said some mad story to me. I went back and I checked another video called Hold You. And that was with him, Chrissy. And I was like, raw, this is vibesy, like, he's not doing what anyone else is doing. I had a friend that my brother was working with called G.I. Doe. Yeah, so basically, G.I. made the connect with Sneakbo. We linked up at the studio. We just started talking.
We were just rolling every day, doing our thing. So I didn't have money like that. So when he would give me £20, £40, yeah, that shit used to help me. I was so broke, I used to ride my pedal bike from Brixton to Camden. And like, go in his house and edit my videos and that.
It was a bit crazy back then. There was a lot of street politics going on and stuff like that. And obviously, I didn't live in Brixton or South London anymore. So I was kind of out of the mix in that sense. So I kind of just took him underneath my wing. Because in my mind, I'm thinking, Rod, this guy's got talent. If I can keep him away from certain street stuff, then maybe he can focus on it. But again, I wasn't a manager. I didn't know the music game.
As I'm always at Shamar's house now, editing my videos and doing my thing there. This is like me getting out the ends. I'm not in the hood, no one knows me here, cool. I'm on the high street going to get kebab or something. I've seen the school kids and it's like him. But I'm thinking, is this Pagan Sisters or something? It was all good vibes. The girls started screaming.
They started singing the bars hard and shit, like going hard. Like, and then I remember him saying, go and get the camera, man, go get the camera. And I thought, oh shit. So I ran back, got the camera, came back out, started filming it.
The love was real. That was the first time I got chased down by a gal screaming.
If you're doing bare videos and putting them on YouTube, you're seeing comments and views. But once you see the people in real life, how it affects them and how it turned them mad and how it made them start dancing and the girls were moving crazy. Bruv, they were moving like he was Michael Jackson. I'm not even trying shit. That's how it felt. It felt like, what the fuck? So for him, I knew he started realizing, raw, this is real. I've got fans. People actually genuinely like me for my music.
Yo, Shine Stan. Before you can them, just wind them.
Hear me a sinner.
You can't bag me up.
Hear me a sinner.
You can't rough me up.
Hear me a sinner.
You can't drape me up.
That man said.
Oh.
You no free of that, no bullshit.
I jumped on that beat twice. The first version was me, Political Peak, JJ, and Tempman. Before we got to even shoot the video, we fell out. I ended up shooting my version with Temp Man.
My name's Jetski, born in the 90s. I move vicious like that when the 9 beats. I'm always gassing.
I shot the video in West End, so that was the first touch of button. And it done well. But Sneakbo, for some reason, he just wanted to go again on it.
We saw Cash and someone else from Peckham jumped on the touch of button beat. We were like, no. We need to do our thing together again, innit? That's what even pushed me to just go extra hard than that.
Then I shot the video to the second one, but the second video, we went Brixton, or I went Brixton anyway.
It was normal. It was like, there was no rentals, there was no fire, there was none of that shit. I was just on the block with the man them, the gal them, the Southside Barbies. That's what they were called at the time.
Big up the old school Southside Barbies. I know they're all big girls, probably got kids and that now. But yeah, big up the Southside Barbies and that.
We're just out there on gang shit, like just good vibes and just turning up on the block, literally.
Came back, edited it, we put it out, and then yeah, the song went off.
For Bowl, it made sense because it was already hot. Like the yard parties, the block parties, the barbecues, that was already going off.
Let me show you the way. Gunman from I don't play games. Batman, now I'm out on the rage. I roll out, then lock off the rage.
That was viral before viral, I think. And believe it or not, back then, them visuals was clean.
Sneak to the boat. Well known, that's I bang bang and I still get dope.
And he was like one of the only artists in the UK jumping on iconic bashment or dancehall rhythms. He was one of the originators of doing that.
They just caught a life of his own, and month by month, year by year, just got crazy.
I just feel like it was the right time. That tune was hard. Vibes Cartel was popping. I was doing my thing, just came out of jail. People probably thought I was gonna get life or something I didn't do. It was just all happening at the right time.
When Bo came with Touch a Button, I can speak for a lot of DJs across the country. He made our jobs easier.
None of us knew that the song was gonna be still getting played 12 years later at shows, at parties. You can go carnival and perform that every year for like the next how many years. That's what you call a classic.
That is like the cheat code record. It's the record you play that you know is gonna have everyone turn. It's gonna have the whole streets in a frenzy.
I'm like in the top 5 biggest songs in the UK. Like, I don't, that's mad. My first ever booking, I just remember going there, bulletproof vest on, and I'm thinking, shit, everyone knows where I am today.
It was in Stratford, East London or somewhere like that. He was obviously nervous and that. I was obviously nervous as well, we all was.
It was a different experience for me to let everyone know, yo, on this day, I'm coming here. So I was just worried, thinking everyone in South that hates me is gonna be there or something.
Did it turn up?
None. Till this day, no. I ain't had no problems like that on my show.
At that time, we was at a level where I didn't know what to do now. We're getting big. People were like, fans are coming around. But we don't have to monetize it because, again, we didn't know about the music game. Man didn't know nothing about it. Like, I just had a vision. Bash called me because obviously I was the man in control of things.
I was looking for new artists and I was always keeping an ear on the newest artists coming out. Obviously, I came across Sneakbo. You could feel the hood in everything that went into making those videos and those songs, and it was just genuine. It was like he had a different flow, his cadence was different. It like stuck in your brain straight away. It was catchy.
There was a few people coming around at the time, but Vash was the one. He had a vision that not a lot of people had. Chart success, that type of angle. And for me, I looked at it and I thought, rah, this kind of makes sense because he might be able to bring us through the door. That's why at that time I told him, let's go with Vash, because at the end of the day, I could see that he knew like the industry.
All I know is this guy you're telling me needs to manage me, manages Chipmunk. and I watched Chipmunk on TV, so I'm involved, cool.
At the time, everyone was looking for commercial rappers who would jump on commercial rap beats with singy hooks, and Sneakbo doing rapping over Bashman. He was like the total opposite. It was raw and it was like fresh. Radio wanted Sneakbo. They wanted to play Sneakbo. We just needed to give them the right record. I connected with Semtex. He was a big push, helping us get onto radio and understanding what kind of sound would work for Sneakbo on radio platforms.
So Rash said, Rod, them same lyrics that I put on Touch a Button, I need to put on this dance, like house type of beat.
I took his Touch a Button lyrics and basically we produced a new house beat around it.
So I got a shout out All Blue as well, James and Darius, because they made the beat and then, yeah, they just remixed Touch a Button.
I remember having a meeting with him and Shamar, I think at Sneakbo's mum's house, and Shamar was against it and Sneakbo said, you know, if I put this out and it flops, it's on you.
This guy's trying to fuck up my whole thing, fam. It's on my beef for music, innit?
We had radio pluggers lined up, we had promo teams lined up, we had a promo campaign, shows that we were going to go and do promo at. But as soon as the week of the promo kicking in, he got nicked and he went to prison.
That time was threats to kill, and yeah, it was basically like, again, wrongfully arrested.
Everything was going right. It was like a dream to reality. Imagine finally we're about to start getting the fruits of our hard work. That fucked everything up differently.
To make matters worse, well, not, they made matters better, but it was more awkward for me. The Wave got playlisted on Radio 1 straight away.
At that time, I had two songs on the radio. I had a song with Angel called Ride Out, and I had The Wave.
We couldn't tell radio that he's in prison because they would have taken him off playlist. So we had to tell them that he's not available or he's traveling and just find excuses.
So we were trying our best to keep things going and trying to keep the game, but it's impossible to keep it going when you've got a single coming out, the video shot, it's gonna go on Channel U, all these type of things. You need to be out here doing the press run.
Every time my music's on radio, everyone banging my cell, saying I should be out here. I'm just thinking this is the opportunity I've been waiting for.
Labels wanted to sign the record, obviously, straight away, because they saw the success that it started with, and he couldn't attend to label meetings. We had to kind of be honest with the labels that he's not going to be here to sign no deal.
At that stage, I'll be real, he probably would have got a top 10 if he was out.
We didn't know if he's going to come out, and when he did come out, it was like, yes, we can get to work.
I don't even get in trouble, but this was just a one-off. Promise you, I'm out of trouble, facing my music, only up from now. My highest moments at that time would definitely be charting. I started getting proper bookings.
That Wave song had man in the countries niggas would dream of going. And at the end of the day, that was like Vash again, because he knew the industry and he knew like the game a bit more than what we knew. He knew if we done this type of song that it's going to get us in a lot of different places, and it did.
He was bringing me to a next level and a new crowd.
Sneakbo ended up having a good following even in like the Dutch house scene and South Africa, and festivals would go off. It really worked with him, that formula.
And all over the UK, oh shit, oh my days. We were traveling the UK, it was a madness back then. Man was doing show after show after show, day after day. It was a fun time.
So I just started clicking through videos and I saw this guy and he had his hoodie on and his glasses and he was with his boys, and what I loved was he was rapping over dancehall beats. And I plugged the computer up to the big speakers and I turned it loud and I was like, whoa, like, I couldn't believe the pockets that he was finding and the consistency of his flows and just the choices that he was making. And I became very, very intrigued with this character that they call Sneakbo. He inspired, like, you know, the way I rapped on cameras and the way I rapped on even Take Care, like, on the song with Rihanna, you know, just the flows that I chose. I mean, obviously, I use melody but just the way he sort of dances through a beat, like when you hear like a beat with some tempo to it, the choices that he makes. I mean, I got a lot of respect for him. There's a lot of UK artists that I love, and you know, it's no disrespect to anybody else, but you know, that was just the person that I.
but he ain't on that.
Since she take it from the back, man.
That was all
yeah,
nigga, how you
feel? Wavy. Right here, on
that. Stay in the circle, stay in the middle.
Me and Young has been dogs, we've been cool.
Our areas are like 5 minutes apart, so we had a lot of mutual friends growing up. So like he would come to my block or whatever and link with my people. And so that's how I know him. Obviously, we started working early on 2010. That's when we proper linked up and built our relationship.
So Young'un ain't on nothing. That track there, that was Young'un's idea.
I was doing my tape Black and Red and it was finished, but felt like there was a tune missing. And man had this beat. I said, this reminds me of Wave Like Bold.
I got a song called Wave Like Bold. And I started off like, you see, tonight, I ain't going to a rave.
And I remember phoning Bo and said, brother, I've got a tune for us. But please, brother, if you can start this tune with, you see, tonight, like you did on Wave Like Bold, because it gave me that feeling.
That tune was as big as Touch a Button in 012, 013. So when he brought that lyric back, only like the real purist that was there will understand like how much that hit.
That's all from Young'un. That was his idea. Just say you see tonight and the rest is history.
You see tonight, I'm on a one night stand. Big anaconda in my pants. I know her and I know she got a man. Man, I take a man, yell and bang, 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 oh shit.
I had hype, everyone knew who I was. Like I had a following, but I didn't have the song. And that was my first song, you get me? That's when I started doing shows. I remember me and Bo was going around doing club shows and mashing up the place. I remember one night, I think we was in Leicester or something, and performing it. It just turned the place upside down. I was just like, bro, man's got to do something. And then that's when I come up with the idea of doing a remix. Snap Capone, Section, Squeaks, and then another remix with Bashy on there, Angel, Gets.
Big dogs like K Coke, J Huss. Central C weren't a big dog then, but he's a big dog now. He even jumped on it.
These are iconic remixes. Like, that was like the only Bashy verse that I remember, like in recent times.
Stormzy used my whole flow from the start to the end. Again, it made me understand that I'm one of the hardest.
That's right, that's right, that's right, that's right.
Table
to
play powder. What, hand movements amazing?
Yeah.
Gora, Gora's, he's like my best friend. He's the funniest person you'll ever meet. One of the realest, always supporting me, always repping Jetski. Before he went in, I weren't doing shows and all of that shit. So when he came out, he was rolling. I could see this guy's proud of me. And he was just turning up at my shows.
Gora, have you heard
Chat trap in the bando. I don't want to look like her. Cheese! Me ran Angel Town, not Skip, not Clemmy, me.
You're an idiot, you know, I swear to God. Bye!
Think about you every single night.
That's right.
When I wake up, I got goals on my mind.
Yo, fresh.
That's my brother from old school days. Can't believe that you died on the block where we played. I'm stressed out because that was my brother. Always had my back when I'm out in the manor. Fresh new clothes, he was ready for the summer round Brixton. Gore, I'll be Prezi Obama. We was young, we was dumb, but we had heart. I love pause, he can make the whole block laugh. Kept me safe, I ain't hiring a bodyguard.
Nah.
Now he's gone, feeling like I lost my right arm. My brother, you was one of a kind. I go everywhere I go, we was living the life on stage every single time, like you see tonight. It's going down when Gores and Kai arrive. Yeah.
RIP Gores.
You love this shit. See, right now, I can't believe we're doing this. D was someone that loved the dream. He loved the music dream. He loved coming to the shows. He loved supporting the men, then, like, he actually loved it.
Yeah,
man. It's sad, man, but you know how the game is already, man. He's got to keep his name alive forever.
Stressed out, thinking what's next. I'm stressed out, thinking what's next. I ain't been sleeping a while, I've been chilling in my car instead. Shit's on my head, how the fuck's big fresh dead fam? None of it don't make sense, I don't know what's next.
What's next?
I lost a real close friend, I don't trust many man on the end, but my heart's in brick.
Every time I'm doing something good, when I shut down somewhere, when I fucking get a new car, just
anything good that I do, go on holiday and I'm living and it was a mad night and I'm just drunk, I always think, nah, this guy should be here. We should experience something. But yeah, I always have to live with that thought.
Cheers! What, bro? What's that, Nando's?
Say the man them out of still. Before me doing good things, positive music.
Say the Trey songs of Brixton, you feel me? Trey songs of Brixton, you feel me?
How much responsibility do you hold that kind of plays a part in keeping that going if
London should have? I feel a lot, even till today. Like, when Gas Gang started, Brixton was Brixton. Now, there's Kennington, Stockwell, Brixton Hill, Summer Leighton. Everyone could have been Brixton, but yeah, now it's a whole new thing. They're not even worried about Peckham no more. They have beef in Brixton now, and that's because of that shit. Like right now, I got a cousin. He's from Brixton Hillsides. He's with them guys. And like, I actually grew up with him. I was close with him. We don't link up, but I got love for him. But it's sad because I can't stop my friends from doing whatever, because he's the main man over there. He can't stop his friends from doing whatever, because I'm the main man, whatever. If I'm with them, we could stop it. We could tell them, no, allow that. But if we're not with them, it's going to go down. Someone's gonna, like, it's gonna happen, innit? So, and that's just the sad reality of the streets that you have to live with. Yeah, the people like Lowski, like his dad from around there. I didn't really know Lowski growing up, but one thing I did know, he's in the back of one of my videos, and yeah, as he got older, the young G's around here violated him or something, and now he don't chill around here. He's gone to the other side, and that's literally what happens with a lot of people that don't get along with us right now. Bro, you could go around, you know. Oh, to say hello. Come through. My guy. Come on, respect, bro.
Yeah.
You live around there?
Yeah, bro.
Oh, come on. Yeah. First time seeing you. Come on, man. You're stunning.
You're legend, bro.
Come on, bro. My guy. You know? Yeah, so what was I saying? They were all around here. Got violated. They're on the other side.
It's like, Sneakbo's always been an artist that don't really care what people say about him on social media. Don't really like addressing it, and that's one of his downfall. And I used to tell him all the time, even when the snitching thing was going on.
Me and my friend was having a problem with someone, and then my friend has accidentally hit me on the head with a crowbar while we're like getting in with this other person, and then boom, friends that weren't even involved in this have had to take me to a hospital. Dropped me off at the hospital, left now, and then I'm in the hospital and I've seen like some different pagans from somewhere else. So I don't know, one of them had an injured foot, so something happened to him. I was dizzy, like, I was just dizzy. I was in a wheelchair in the hospital. When I've seen them, it's like, I just came back to life. I've got up, I'm causing a scene basically. I'm like, you lot better fuck me up now. They're not on nothing, they're just there. People have come to the hospital. They're just coming back to the hospital because the hospital was active that day. So they came back to the hospital and chairs have been thrown, things have been thrown, it's all on camera. Obviously I got arrested because the police think I called my friends. I didn't call no one. Months later now, the person that said I'm a snitch, his mum's a lawyer. She's phoned me and told me that guy's got nicked. They're gonna come for you. You and my man are just seen on camera, just going to the hospital and coming back. He said something like that or something cool. So when I got nicked, I said, yes, that's my bridgin. He brought me to the hospital and that's it. After that, it's a no comment interview. SWV, all the men, couple men, bare men were on that case. We've all got NFA. Now it's like, me and this guy ain't really close, but I was talking to a girl he knows and it hurt his feelings. And yeah, from there, I just woke up one day and man's randomly calling me a snitch. At that time, I'm really not this internet guy. I'll just come to my man's house, which I was doing. And then, funny enough, they snitched on me and I went jail for 1 week. It's all there, all the proofs there. So they're calling me the snitch, but they're the ones who put me in jail because I was going to their house when they were tweeting. every time they tweeted something or did something disrespectful on my name, I would go violate them. I'll see their uncles on Edgware Road, I'll smash their window, whatever. I'll just always be on fuckeries because people are violating. Now it's like, everyone knows I'm not a snitch. The hood knows I'm not a snitch. The real people know I'm not a snitch. But what bothers me is there's still fans out there when I post certain things that might say Sneakbo's a snitch or Sneakbo, or like my ops, they're happy to use that snitch thing, like when they know deep down I'm not a snitch. But yeah, this is how people want to bring me down. And I feel like that's the only thing in my whole career that has ruined my career, that's made some people, deep down they respect me, but they can't show they respect me.
In the streets, you don't address things on social media or whatever, but as a man, that's one of my regrets that I didn't fight for us to get to the bottom of, because I know in my heart, if Sneakbo has snitched, I won't be sitting there right now. There's a lot of gangsters in the streets, a lot of guys that, wherever, they're cool with Sneakbo, because they know the truth. Truth, 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 truth.
Do you think there will ever be peace?
No. Never. Never. There will be peace between people, like, but it's never gonna be like everyone's peaceful. I don't think so. I don't know.
Nah. Just keep it real, man. It's not happening. Don't think it's happening still. I know a lot of men would love it for it to be peace, but it's not happening. Definitely not happening.
We talk about reality, it's gonna get worse because someone's gonna die and more people's gonna be angry. That's just life in that, in the streets, and yeah.
With that in mind, what regrets do you have in
your life? Oh, do I have regrets? Like, you, like with me, it's just... like... if I could, I would. I'll tell my friends, fuck the pagans. Yo, let's do this, do that. There's loads of business things we could do, or music things, or whatever. It's not really about killing each other and beefing each other and hurting each other. That's where it's sad and wrong. Learning from life, like, this is what I'm saying. I've just turned 30. I've been through so much shit. My friends have been through so much shit. My friends are in jail for murder. My friends have got murdered. Being a dad now and looking at my son and being so happy seeing him and him making me laugh, me loving him, and then me thinking about, oh, I want this for him in the future, or I want him to be like this in the future. Just looking forward to his future. And then one day someone kills him. Lately, it's like, when I see all these kids dying and youths dying, actually now, and this is people I don't even know, it proper hurts me. Because I'm looking at my son growing and I'm thinking, this person's mum, this is a big youth that's 20 something, but my son's 3, I've only known him for 3 years and I love him. Can't wait to see him next year, can't wait to see him get his license, can't wait to see him bring a girl home, can't wait to see him do certain stuff, buy a house, whatever, just accomplish stuff. And yeah, like these other parents, man, their kids have got murdered. All that 20 years they've been through, that I'm excited about this 3 years. It's just, it's sad, it's too sad, man.
Both grew up in the bricks. Love him, that's my dog. Used to play with six, never knew about cards. Aiming for the moon, we were shooting for the stars. Can't believe they gave my brother life, but I am bars. I've been rolling seat back, trying to relax. Let me fill a zubby, tell me where the weed at. Drop another banger, let me get your feedback. I ain't got a hell of views, but I don't even pre that. I'm still alive, still free. Lately I've been doing me. I don't need to follow fashion, I'm just doing as I please. Play mob deep as I'm dipping through the streets. Fam, I've had a long day and I just wanna go sleep. New beef, new ops, I'm in war with different blocks. Coming like it never stops, I ain't getting switched off. Bullets fly, gunshots, round hair it goes off. I pray I never get dropped. I don't wanna die, I don't wanna go. Praying that I make it, that I make it back home. Hustle on the low, make money on the roads. Money coming fast, the money used to come slow. I don't wanna die, I don't wanna go. Praying that I make it, that I make it back home. Hustle on the low, make money on the roads. Money coming fast, the money used to come slow. All I wanted was a Benz. Got it in the end. Summer two-faced, I just need a true friend. If you're talking about chains, fam, I got about 10. Can't take it to the grave, does it really make sense? Now I do this for my son, that's my number one. Love him till I die, love him till my life done. I hope that when I'm gone, you still listen to my songs. Trying to make your life better, hope you're proud of what I've done. Daddy loves you, hugs you, we kick it like kung fu. Grew up in the hood, I won't raise you in the jungle. Be just like your daddy, go and make your mommy proud. Life ain't been the same since Lorenzo been about, I'm hella grateful, hustle so I'm stable. Thank God that I could put food on the table. My old phone disabled, don't play, I ain't playful. Lord knows that I'm grateful.
Brixton is fine, but to bring the children up there, I don't think it's fine anyway. Because too much drug, everything is there. But now, I think Brixton is better. It's full of white people now. It's full of restaurants. Sorry to say white people, but yeah.
People say the Peckham boys chased me into McDonald's, kicked the door open, they saw my clothes on the floor and a cat on top of it. Cool, I hear that. But if that was true, one, there'll be footage from McDonald's. Two, till this day, there's not been no Peckham boy that's ever said he ran me down.
I've never seen him turn into a cat personally. But then again, I've not always kept my eye on him. So, you know him, bro, you never know.
Even three, the McDonald's worker would be like, yo, my man turned into a cat.
Waiting for this cat to go.
Cat's chilling, man. The cat's in
Yeah, talk us about